Hi, I'm Dan Kibiski, co-chair of the Society of Professional Journalists International Community. And today we're going to talk about the TOR project. And when you go to their website, right up front, it says, defend yourself against tracking and surveillance, circumvent censorship. With me is Isabella Bigueras, and I think I said that wrong, but please correct me later when Isabella. She's from the TOR project, and she will explain a bit more about TOR and how journalists can benefit from it. Real quick history, TOR started in the 1990s and as the internet was getting going, and experts in the field realized the use of the internet could lead to tracking and surveillance. This is especially a problem as dissidents against dictators tried to organize online. TOR was instrumental during the Arab Spring, beginning in the late 210. And it not only protected people's identity online, but allowed them to access crucial resources, social media, and websites. Over the years, TOR has been proven to be an asset to democracy activists and working journalists. So now I'd like to bring in Isabella. And Isabella, that was a very bare bones introduction I gave to TOR. You're the expert. Tell me, you know, would you like to tell us a little bit more about TOR, please?
Thank you, Dan. Thank you for the introduction and the invitation. And yes, TOR project is a nonprofit behind TOR, the technology, right? And TOR is two things right now. One is a network. So we have the free software where people run on relays, on servers. And we have around 7,000 to 8,000 of those around the world run by volunteers that builds this network that our users use to connect and be protected, connect anonymously on the internet and be protected against surveillance and also bypass censorship. And then we have the Tor browser, which is a fork of Firefox with some modifications as well on the client side to do the same, right? Like protect your data for surveillance, allows you to stay anonymous and also help as an interface to make it easier for you to use Tor and access the web, right? Like, so those are the main technology that we put out there for the user right now. And we do this because our mission is to actually advance human rights through building technology that is providing privacy, anonymity, and helping people bypass censorship. So that's why we are so invested on doing that. And like you said, this is a matter that this conversation and the designing of this technology started in the 90s, going through realization that should be an open source free software technology and should not be controlled by nobody, should be decentralized to, for it to meet its needs, right? Like its proposed, its goals. So then the project, the nonprofit was created to govern it over the technology. Then we have, in the history, right? Like we have some changes in the UIs and move on forward with, and those are continue. But I think on the matter of awareness, there was a huge spike in 2013, but then we have a continuous spike every time either democracy or access to information or human rights are at risk that people sees and learns about TOR and they seek TOR to help them go through that process and, you know, just fight for their rights and or fight for democracy. It depends on the problem, on the matter that they're facing, right? Yeah.
Okay. All right. So it sounds like a great program, but I also understand it's really hard to break, that you can protect yourself really well. Can you talk a little bit about the security that's involved?
Yes. So if you look at the network side that I was talking about, that decentralized network with 7,000 relays or servers around the world, the way Tor works is when you are using the browser, right? Like using to access a website, the browser will send your connection through our network. And then your connection, it will bounce through three of the servers, where the communication between the first one, the middle one, and the third or exit one, that communication is fully encrypted. And each one is a different layer of encryption. That's why it comes from Tor. It stands for the onion routing, and the right, like just like an onion, you have the layers and the layers of encryption. On the top of that, so that also means that the first relay will know who you are, but the middle one, when they talk to each other, the middle one has no idea who you are. They only know what the first relay is telling them. And then the last one, the third one, or the exit one, will have no idea which one was the first one, or that who you, the first one was in touch with you. The only information they have is what the middle one gave it to them, right? So nobody, not only is it a very simplistic way of explaining Tor and how that increases your, protects your connection on the internet because it gives you all these layers of encryption. Also obfuscate your original IP address because what's gonna go out is whatever third one around the world that you that was selected for you, IP address that will go out. Also, depending on the use case, it will also, if you are using Tor to connect to an ONI address, which is instead of like going out to the normal internet, you stay inside of the Tor network to talk with that service, you also benefit of obfuscation of your metadata. So beyond just having the normal end-to-end encryption that people are used to, where your password or username is protected when you're accessing a service, this in this case, you also have encryption of the metadata, and sometimes not even any metadata being exposed or collected or used, depending on the on the service that you're using. So I feel like you end up gaining a lot of protection with the whole technology. And on the client side, on the browser side, we added a bunch of other ones, like things that nowadays are very used and people can see on the news. For instance, third-party cookie protection or fingerprinting protection, tab isolation, right? Like all those things for cookie isolation, all those things are techniques that we created over the years. And now in the, which we are happy to see, the industry try to provide better privacy on the browser experience to the user. They are incorporating some of these techniques in there. So it's important to mention those two because I feel just the protection of the network or the connection is not enough. You also need to think about what information can get, can leak about you on the client side as well. Depend, like be that the client, the browser, or application on a mobile device.
Okay. So there is a lot of security protection of your identity. Does it, when working as a journalist, sometimes journalists may be talking to dissidents, they may be talking to people that certain governments may not want to be talking to journalists. How can Tor help journalists protect themselves from government interference, but also protect their sources from being exposed or being identified?
That's a great question. Actually, we have amazing tools that was created with the journalist use case as the center point of that. One of them is very well known. It's called SecureDrop. And SecureDrop uses those ONI addresses that I was talking about. So it's an interface and you have a whole setup behind it that the Freedom of the Press Foundation is the organization who develops that tool, and they can provide any news outlet, right? Like newsroom with that support. But it's a website where the journalist will be talking with the source. And it has this kind of like forum, right? Like back and forward posting that is encrypted with an encryption key that only the source has the one copy of the key and the journalist has the other. And it is accessible only through the ONI address. So only from inside of the Tor network that someone can open and interact with this tool, which, like I said, provides not only end-to-end encryption, but also obfuscation of metadata, right? Like, so if I'm only, for instance, if I'm using Signal, which is, right, like a messaging tool, or WhatsApp, which is also a messaging tool that has encryption, end-to-end encryption on the content, my metadata is still exposed. So it shows that I am the journalist, and I contact this person on this date at this time, and then another date at another time. And then you can correlate that with other things that I, the journalist, did, or where I was, my geolocation, and you can expose just by examining the data, the metadata. I think Signal has a point here where they have very minimal metadata about you, and they don't store that. And when they do store that, it's encrypted and it's very short of time. So all of those bonus points count for Signal. But I feel security drop and other tools, when using an ONI address, this is not even a concern whatsoever, right? Like, so that is another one, call it global leaks, which is also similar to security drop. And as a matter of fact, not only news outlets use that, but governments too, to receive information for whistleblowing, and which is interesting. And I feel like another tool that has been created because of a use case of a journalist that I recommend is OnionShare. OnionShare is a very simple app that I can easily drop a file in that app, and then that app will create the Onion address for me, and I can share that Onion address either through Signal, right, like a secure tool, and the person on the other side who has the Onion address can open on Tor network and download the file. The benefits of this tool is that there is no cloud service. The file is always on your computer. Your computer becomes the service. And while you are running that, the address is available. And for the person who is downloading that file, it's also super secure for them, right? Like, again, metadata, end-to-end encryption, et cetera, to do so. So this is useful not only for, I have seen this being quite useful. And this was actually something created when journalists was talking with Snowden, Glenn Greenwald, and Laura Poitras, right? Like, they needed to have a very secure way to share files. There was no cloud servers in the middle. So it was a tool developed by someone, Michael Lee, who works in The Intercept. So he's a tech engineer who works for a news outlet developing tools for journalists. And initially he created for this use case, but then he released it as an open source, and now has more resources on the tool beyond just sharing files. But I feel I have seen this use case not only being useful for a journalist, right, like to get information out, but I feel like also being useful for human rights lawyers to receive information from people who are at risk. Because the people, like I am a campesino, I am fighting on the front line. I'm indigenous, part of an indigenous community group. I'm on the front line. My life is at risk. I know who was killed by who. I have all that information. And if anyone knows that I'm talking with you, I'm at risk. So how I give you the proven evidence of crimes most of the time committed by either by state law, right, like the state, by military, police, or whatever, or by militias, right? And that most of the time in most countries, militias are associated with the state forces. So how I can be in communication with you that nobody knows that I'm talking with you and giving you the evidence for you, the lawyer, right? Like to build your case and bring it to the court. So it's been useful in many cases like that too. So I feel like I think those are tools that are specifically useful for a journalist to have back and forward conversation with a source. Onion Security Drop is like a forum, right? Like it's more static, kind of like the back and forward of an email, right? And has it to hold apparatus behind it to make sure that when you do receive those files, you have the security to how to open and distribute that to your crew so you can work on them. Also, I had to say, of course, I need to mention this. I think WikiLeaks used Tor to receive the leaks, and Julian Assange has been one of the first journalists to incorporate Tor as a way to receive and have secure communication with it, his sources, the WikiLeaks sources, during this whole process. So I feel like I need to put it out there that his case right, like of extradition is a huge danger against journalists, not against his life alone, but the whole profession of journalism. And I feel that the support that they had to adopt our technology in this use case and put it out there that like this is a technology could be used for this specific case was mm-hmm. a huge visionary, right? Like type of a thing that put it out there, like we can combine those two and this can be extremely powerful for journalism. So I need to also recognize that.
Okay, what you've been talking about so far is communication between people or among people. Does this offer protection on your computer? So if the journalist was grabbed by somebody from state security, can they see the information on that journalist's computer?
Yes, that's a great question. So no, Tor does not provide a security to your computer. It provides security for when you're talking or accessing things online or sharing things online, right? I would advise journalists, there is another tool called Tails, which is an operating system crafted to be secure, right? Like especially for people who needs a high level of security about what they're doing with the computer and to leave no trace behind whatsoever as they're using a computer. So the way you use Tails is that you download that operating system. And don't worry, the Tails website has a lot of information that can give you a better tutorial than what I'm just going to explain right now. But you can download that, put it on a pen drive, and then you can set up your computer to boot from the pen drive. So you're going to start an operating system from that USB stick. And the moment you're done doing whatever you're doing, nothing has been stored on the hardware of your computer. And the USB stick, everything that you did will be erased. And the next time you fire it up, it's going to be a whole new startup, right? Like of the operating system. So this is also a good point to keep in mind, because if you save a file and you unplug, that file is gone, right? Like it's not going to be saved for real. So that is good for you to do certain, right? Like open certain things. If you are opening a file, and I would recommend using a tool like that. For your own computer, there are a lot of measurements that I would recommend, like security, there's no silver bullet, right? Mm-hmm. From like encrypting your hard drive to a really good policy for passwords. I feel like sometimes the weak link that someone has is the password habit. What they use for passwords, how they formulate a password, are they using the same one everywhere? You know, like those habits are the most vulnerable ones that you see that is the entry point of any vulnerability, you know?
Okay. Because I read, you know, was reading through the Tor page and I thought, you know, it was, you know, Tor itself was not a computer security, but that there are other options and ways to protect your data just in case state security does decide to go through your laptop or your phone or tablet, whatever you're traveling with. I want to thank you very much. This is, as I said, this is an introduction to Tor. We will be posting your website URL with this video, so people will be able to go take a look at it. I have found that it's a very good place to get information. Your team there is very helpful in walking through to set things up. Is there anything else you would like to say or comment on for specifically for journalists?
Yes, I want to add one thing, right? Like, and I hope if you are a journalist, listen to this, that you never had to face this situation. But sometimes as a journalist, you don't have a place to publish your news. You don't have like a safe space to publish. And only addresses can, only share also serve as that, can be your way of publishing things anonymously, protecting your identity, but putting the news out. So you can easily fire up an own address, a website where you don't need to buy a domain. You don't need to pay for hosting service. It can be self-hosted on your computer for a temporary, right, like a publish of news or sharing the news with the world, where you find yourself in a place where there is no other place, no other way for you to put the information out. So I feel like it would be great to explore that too as well, thinking about that use case. And I hope you don't see yourself on that use case, but in case you see yourself in that, you know that is a solution, there's a way, there's technology there that helps you put the information out without fear of retaliation or anything like that, completely secure and anonymous for yourself, yeah, to do it.
Oh, wow, that's wonderful. I guess I didn't read far enough to learn more about that. All right, Isabella, thank you very much. I do very much appreciate you taking the time to explain Tor to the Society of Professional Journalists. I have a feeling you'll be seeing a few of our people downloading your software and taking advantage of what is, I have seen as an excellent program, because I know people who are very much into technology and cybersecurity, and they just say, what a tough beast Tor is to crack. So I'm very happy to have had the time with you.
Thank you, Dan. I'm very happy to be here. And yeah, happy to answer any other questions in the future as well. I'm available for any moment.
Thank you again.